In this video, we will explore some very important and fundamental aspects of quantum theories. The topic in this video will not only help us understand the structure of the atom better, but we will also take a look at some of the more fundamental math of quantum mechanics, which form the basis for many-body quantum theories. This concept not only applies to quantum mechanics, but it can be generalized to quantum field theory, which we will discuss in the future. Essentially, this video will look at some of the foundation which is necessary to build our most successful theory of explaining the building blocks of our universe, namely the standard model. More precisely, today's video is about the Pauli exclusion principle and the underlying math behind bosons and fermions. In a previous video about the uncertainty principle, we got introduced to the new mathematical object called the operator. As discussed in that video, operators are a key to how quantum mechanics work. If you didn't see that video, feel free to check it out, but let us anyway do a quick recap. In quantum mechanics, we generally replace numbers with operators. Numbers are simple because it doesn't matter in what order you consider multiplication. As an example, 3 times 2 is equal to 2 times 3 and it's equal to 6. When it doesn't matter what way around you multiply your objects, then objects commute. Numbers always commute, which makes them simple. In quantum mechanics, things are more complex and we have operators which do not necessarily commute. Which means that for two general operators A and B, we have that AB is not equal to BA. Thus, we can write the commutation relation using bracket notation. A, B in brackets is equal to AB minus BA. This equation, we can also see that the reverse relation is almost the same, but with a minus sign in front. B, A in brackets is equal to minus A, B in brackets. As you will see later, this is important for bosons. To build a realistic model of the universe, we need matter. And in quantum physics, one can add or remove matter using special operators, creatively called annihilation and creation operators. The exact definition of these operators is not important, but we usually denote the annihilation operator as A hat and the creation operator as A hat dagger. Using ket notation, we can consider a quantum system and look at how the creation and annihilation operators work. We can consider the state with n particles. Let's say we start with 0 particles, thus n is equal to 0. This means we consider the vacuum state. What happens if we try to apply the annihilation operator? A hat applied to the vacuum state is equal to 0, we get nothing. This state doesn't exist, you can't have a negative amount of particles. This might sound like I'm just making the rules, but there is a lot of underlying math that I'm just sparing you from. For the purpose of this video, the most important thing is to get the grasp of what happens and to realize that there are some logic to the madness. Now let's see what happens if we add the creation operator to the same vacuum state. A hat dagger applied to the zero vacuum state is equal to a state of 1. Whoa, we have a particle in the system. So what if we try this again? Now we add our A hat dagger creation operator to the state 1 and we get the square root of 2 times the state 2. We now have 2 particles in the system. But now there's a factor of square root 2 and this is actually a normalization factor. Finally, we can consider using the annihilation operator on our state with 1 particle. So if we add A hat to our 1 state, we get back our 0 vacuum state. The general equation you can use to play around with this is given as A hat applied to the state n is equal to square root of n and then the state n minus 1, and for the creation the A hat dagger applied to state n is equal to the square root of n plus 1 on the state n plus 1. So if you want to play around with this on your own, feel free. All the particles can essentially be divided into 2 categories, bosons and fermions. As we will see, these 2 types of particles are fundamentally different. An example of a boson is the photon, or light. Bosons form symmetric quantum states, and as it turns out, this means that the commutation relation of the annihilation and creation operators can be defined in terms of the commutation relations a hat, a hat dagger in brackets is equal to 1. Without going into too much details yet, bosons have their own special properties, and as we will see later, they are very important in terms of conveying forces. Now we can do something similar for fermions. A fermion is, for example, an electron. Because fermions are antisymmetric, they must be defined in terms of the anticommutator, where we have a hat, a hat dagger in this anticommutation brackets, and that's equal to 1. And this anticommutator is defined similar to the commutator, but with a plus sign, so we have that anticommutation relation between A and B is AB plus BA. This leads to the fact that it doesn't matter how we write the commutation relations, since the anticommutation of B, A is the same as the anticommutation of A, B. This is a very subtle but important difference compared to that of bosons' commutation relations, which were that BA in brackets is equal to minus AB in the brackets, as mentioned earlier. We won't go more into the details of annihilation and creation operators for now, but this definition of bosons and fermions lays the foundation of how we treat the two types of particles when we build quantum theories. The fundamental property that determines if a particle is a boson or a fermion is its spin. What is spin? It's something that doesn't exist in the classical world, and it's therefore hard to describe. Consider a ball and spin it around clockwise or anticlockwise. This gives you two states, to spin clockwise or to spin anticlockwise. The situation is more complicated, but this is where the spin analogy comes from. Each particle can either spin in one or the other direction. Usually, one calls one direction the upstate and the other direction the downstate. Particles, however, are not like balls, and this example is just an analogy of how to interpret it. Spin is an intrinsic property, but the spin analogy helps with the understanding. The important part is that all particles have a spin number. Particles with integer spin numbers, like 0, 1 and 2, are bosons. And particles with half spin numbers, like a half, 3/2, etc., they are fermions. Electrons and quarks are all spin half particles, thus they are fermions. Photons are spin 1 particles, thus they are bosons. Now that we have introduced the concept of bosons and fermions, we can consider the wave functions. If we consider a system with a particle 1 with a state A and a particle 2 with state B, we might naively write the product of the two particle states as psi of 1 and 2, psi 1 in state A and psi 2 in state B, where psi 1 2 is the combined state of particle 1 and particle 2. This is the logical way to do it according to classical physics, where you can distinguish the particles. But in quantum physics, this is not the case. If you consider two electrons, they are indistinguishable. Labeling them 1 and 2 is meaningless in a practical sense. You just have two electrons. There is no way to physically label them. It's only a theoretical thing. Now to fix this, we must get back to the two types of particles. We must ask the question, what happens if we swap the state of two particles around? For boson, the answer is absolutely nothing. We can thus write that psi 1 of state A times psi 2 state B is equal to psi 1 in state B times psi 2 in state A. This is because bosons are symmetric. Now, as mentioned earlier, fermions are antisymmetric, and you can maybe already guess what happens in this case. We get that psi 1 in state A times psi 2 in state B is equal to minus psi 1 in state B times psi 2 in state A. There is a minus sign's penalty for swapping antisymmetric particles. This is fundamental in giving the universe structure, as we will discuss later. Now we can finally discuss the most important part of the video, namely the Pauli exclusion principle. If we now write the system of our two particles in the correct quantum way, in terms of indistinguishable particles, that the wave function of the two bosons is equal to 1 over square root 2 times psi 1 in state A, psi 2 in state B, plus psi 1 in state B times psi 2 in state A for the bosons, the term in front is a normalization number because we consider a superposition in the quantum world. Finally, we can consider the equation for fermions, where psi f is 1 over square root 2 times psi 1 in state A times psi 2 in state B minus psi 1 in state B times psi 2 in state A, where we now have a minus sign because fermions are antisymmetric. Now here comes the crazy part. If we set particle 1 and particle 2 to have the same state A, we get two very different results. For the bosons, we just get that psi B is equal to 1 over square root 2 times psi 1 in state A times psi 2 of state B 2 times. Thus, we just get psi 1 of state A times psi 2 of state A, as one might logically expect. Note that the normalization factor cancels the sum from summing the two particle states. If we, on the other hand, consider the fermion case, we see that due to the minus sign, they cancel each other. So we have that psi f is just equal to zero. This is the Pauli exclusion principle. What this tells us is that two identical fermions cannot occupy the same quantum state, but two bosons can, and this makes a huge difference. The fact that fermions cannot occupy the same state plays a huge role in giving structure to the quantum world. Take for example the atom. Because the protons and the neutrons are made of fermions, they must be separated such that they don't occupy the same state. The same can be said for the electrons. They must be placed in different shells because each shell is limited by the exclusion principle and how many electrons it can accommodate. Thus, we see that one of the reasons that the atom has its given size is because of the exclusion principle, which doesn't allow it to be any smaller. The electrons would prefer to be in a shell closer to the center of the atom, but they are not allowed to. Pauli initially discovered this exclusion principle for electrons, and it was later generalized to the spin statistics theory. As always, feel free to comment, like and subscribe. I would appreciate to hear from you guys what you like and didn't like in the comments. And if you have any ideas for new topics, let me know. Stay tuned for the next video.